Welcome again to Evolutionary Psychology, to better understand your world, a YouTube video channel about the power of evolutionary thinking. Animals and plants are not our main subject of discussion. People, politics and societies are. Inspiring, sometimes controversial, but always stretching your mind. In this episode, we are going to talk about our own biological evolution, our most intimate history. How did we grow from apes to man? What forces and special circumstances shaped us? Where did we acquire our very special features? All very important questions that tell us a lot about our modern way of living, our societies and the problems we encounter. I cannot present quick and easy solutions for these problems, but I promise evolutionary psychology is going to give you a lot of new perspectives to look at all challenges. Men and apes, especially chimps and bonobos and we ourselves, have a common ancestor. About 5 to 6 million years ago, our pedigrees split. How do we know this? From fossils? Hardly. No, the main source of information on this topic comes from genetic differences and similarities between us and our cousins. DNA has a mutation rate of about 0.71% every million years. Chimps and humans share about 98% of their DNA. So, estimates of the 5 to 6 million years are based on this kind of evidence. But keep in mind, the numbers have quite substantial margin of error. Let's have a look at some of our very special features. Why do we walk straight up? Why bipedalism? A lot of ideas have been suggested. It helps you to spot your enemies more quickly, some say. That is true. But on the other hand, your enemy also sees you a lot quicker. Standing up makes the surface the sun can burn upon much smaller. It also explains the hair on our head, to shield off the heat from the sun. Okay, but why do other mammals in tropic heat walk on four legs? Are baboons more vulnerable to heat strokes than humans? Hardly. Another explanation focuses on making our hands free for handling tools and weapons. Maybe, but it leaves the question open of which was first, the chicken or the egg. In this video, we are going to gather the pieces of the puzzle and join them as much as possible together afterwards. The puzzle will remain incomplete and the isolated pieces may not be completely convincing to you. But the puzzle, as far as we get, will provide a very interesting and compelling picture. We start with an old friend, the vampire. Remember his clever insurance system and how he managed to prevent fraud and deceit. Big brains evolved to recognize and remember each bat in the group. And from that, the first building blocks of a system of emotions on justice, fairness and unfairness emerged. The necessity to share food, blood in this case, was the main driver behind this remarkable piece of evolution. Humans are meat-sharing animals too, and this requires a form of social accounting, recognizing each other as individuals and remember what you gave them and what you received from others. To this type of behavior, we can trace back TOM, theory of mind. This is our capacity to know we have consciousness and to infer that other people have this too. And sometimes we even overdo it and assume that things or processes are intentional agents too. A mistake laying at the origins of religion. TOM is a device to run social experiments in our head. If I do this, how will my friend react? What will he think? And what can I do to make him think something else? This tool helps us in our social interactions, for the good, but also for the bad. For example, by thinking ways how to deceive others and get away with it. As a consequence, it helps us to detect fraud against us. A thief is the best expert in demasking other thieves. The same goes for unmasking fraud and deceit in normal everyday life. The arms race this caused may be one of the more important origins behind our big brains. But first, are we carnivores? The number of vegans is growing in our society. But despite this, yes, we originated as meat eaters, as omnivores in fact. The anthropologists Aiello and Wheeler came up with the gut-brain swap hypothesis. Look at a cow and a cheetah. What strikes the eye? A cow has a very big belly. They have to eat a lot of plants to extract a relatively small portion of nutrients from it. A meat eater doesn't encounter this problem. Almost everything he eats consists of valuable resources. Meat has a high sustenance, so his bowels can be much, much shorter. And what do humans like? Are we more like cows, or do they resemble the cheetah? In our modern day world, this question may be a bit confusing. But when you look at hunter-gatherers, they are mostly tightly trained athletes with perfect six-packs. Carnivores we were, no doubt about that. Put a cow in a cage with only chopped pork and she will starve to death. Do the same with a lion or a human and they will survive. So we ate meat. But wait, we differ a lot from most carnivores. On some aspects we look more like herbivores. We are without big claws, without big teeth, and without with superior speed or body strength. This has puzzled scientists for long. How to make sense of this set of inconsistent features? One very elegant solution has been proposed by Alistair Hardy, the aquatic ape hypothesis. This is the idea that we lived at least for a period in our evolution on the seashores. Not as real sea animals, we were no seals or dolphins, but more like shore dwellers, eating fish, mallards and shellfish and maybe gathering eggs from seabirds and eating plants growing in brackish areas. What are his arguments for supporting this idea? Hardy mentioned some unique properties of humans that can hardly be explained otherwise than assuming we didn't go from forest to savanna, but we had an intermediate phase at the sea. Hear what Hardy has to say. First, the positioning of fats and muscle in our body. Our bodies are streamlined like a fish or sea mammal. A good swimmer makes a dive into a pool and moves 25 yards without a single stroke. Compare that to a dog splashing into the water. His speed on land is much higher than of any human, but once touching the water, the dog loses all its velocity. Humans don't. So in a way, we are adapted to being in water. Second, we have a strong diving reflex. Entering water automatically holds our breath. Even babies do this. Furthermore, we are very skilled in regulating our breathing in a very fine way. Dolphins are the real masters in this. And it has been said that dolphins have committed suicide in captivity just by holding their breath. No other land animal can do that. Our nose openings are pointed down. This prevents water entering. All other carnivores have their noses pointed to the front. Furthermore, land carnivores have very acute smell. We haven't. But we are joined in this by sea mammals like dolphins. They have hardly any smell sense too. It's clearly why. A dolphin doesn't use smell to hunt. We do neither. The little sense of smell left is to detect if meat or fish we found is still fresh and eatable. Our weak teeth and claws are not fit to tear and eat raw meat from big prey. But they do fit if our diet consists of soft structures like fish, clams and mallards. Later on we discovered fire. From then on we could eat tough meat too. But that is something for later. Our big brains needed a lot of proteins to grow. An abundant diet of fish and other proteins found at shore can provide this. Why do we lose lots of salt when we cry or sweat? This makes no logic for savanna or desert dwellers living in tropical areas. You might expect they do everything to keep the valuable salts into their body, but we do exactly the opposite. And you have already guessed it, this makes only sense for a sea or shore animal. Too much salt in your body is poisonous, so we had to get rid of it as much and as frequently as possible. Look at a seal in a zoo. They are crying all the time, maybe because they are unhappy, but more likely to pour out the excess of salt. So we didn't live near rivers and freshwaters, but at sea coasts. It must have been a kind of mangrove coastline with big mud flats flooding and being waterless with the tides. There, food could be found in abundance. We now know that East African coast has been like that for a long while, but changed later, which of course forced us to another way of life. Then there is our naked skin. This is quite common for water animals in tropical regions. Think of dolphins, hippos and manatees. The elephant as a savanna animal is long used as an argument against the aquatic ape theory, But recent findings reveal that elephants have evolved in water too. This explains their bigness. And, no kidding, their trunk was used as a snorkel. Together with humans, elephants are among the rare animals that like to play in water. Can we prove the aquatic ape hypothesis? Is there hard and indisputable evidence? No, not yet. Fossils haven't been found. But at the other hand, beaches are no ideal spot for fossils to be preserved either. However controversial, the hypothesis still stands as a very viable option. However speculative it might be, I want to add something extra to the water ape idea. Shores are very densely populated areas. Both in water and on land, there is a high supply of food available. Shallow waters with a lot of sunlight and oxygen attract a lot of life forms, both from the deeper sea as well as from the land. This makes shores the most animal-rich areas on our planet. So it is to be expected that our watery ancestors met a lot of individuals of their own kind. And this opens two options: fighting each other until you gain the monopoly on a stretch or offshore, or, and that's the second option, to work together and form bigger groups. The second option won, made possible by the abundance of high-quality food. What facts are there to support this thesis? The main argument is that humans are the primates living in the largest groups. We did then, and we still do. Robin Dunbar is the most important thinker on the subject of human group size. He came up with the number of 150 people as a kind of upper limit to our group size. Everywhere in human societies, this number comes back. It's the average number of people a single individual can have personal contact with, it's the ideal size of an army unit, and organizations growing bigger than 150 people have to work on a more formal, bureaucratic way. With smaller units can operate much more flexible and on a personal basis. People know each other and can solve problems without too much formal rules. Eckhart Winsen, the founder of BSO Origin, had the policy to split up units once they reached this magic number. This way he kept his organization flexible and adaptive. Chimps and gorillas flee each other as a kind of social interaction. It maintains friendships and heals relationships after conflicts. With 150 people, it becomes hard to flee each other physically. And this is where language came in. Some already existing factors, I will name them in a moment, got an extra impulse by the need to replace the physical fleeing. Language was probably already developing. We had these big brains. We had TOM and superior social and cognitive skills. We walked straight up and our food was very palatable and easy to chew. So our nose and especially our lips and tongue could grow smaller but more flexible and with a lot of dexterity in it, caused by the need to open tiny shell of mallocks and cockles. This also spurred the finer motor skills in our fingers. Language probably originated as sign language, which is a full-scale form of language with the same level of complexity as spoken language. Our advanced hand movements, there's no other animal that can write, made it possible to communicate by mimicking. If I wanted to tell how I caught a big fish, I reenact the entire adventure. And because of my TOM, I could envision myself if you would be able to understand my message, just as I'm doing now. I'm constantly checking if my words convey the right message, if you really are receiving what I want to send to you. This could be the basis of our language, later added with sounds, which after that took over the essentials of our languages. The speech centers in our brain are located in the Broca and Wernicke areas, the areas that control the finer motor skills of face and hands. Note, the sound areas of other species are almost always located at the areas controlling emotions, which makes our language so fundamentally different from most animal sounds. Okay, let's connect the dots. We are carnivores. We share meat. This caused TOM and big brains. Life as aquatic ape explains a lot of which couldn't be explained if we only placed our evolution on the hot plains of dry Africa. The sea gave us an abundance of proteins. Sight and touch dominated over smell and sound. Visual coding, mimicking, and hand dexterity, sign language, created the stage for what was to become language as we know it today. The fish we ate created the conditions for the evolution of our delicate mouth and nose, and our superior dexterity in these body parts. Life in water also caused our superior skills in breathing, a precondition for spoken language. From fleeing each other to language, that was an important piece of our heritage from the big groups at shores. But the story is not over yet. We do not live at shores anymore. How did this happen? Probably conditions at the coast of East Africa changed. But how did we move back to the dry and harsh conditions of tropical savanna? How did we survive this highly dangerous transition? One might expect this would have changed not only our living conditions dramatically, but also our body and minds. One logical route evolution could take was for us to grow back into some kind of carnivore ape. A big hairy predator ape with big teeth, huge claws, a strong and fast body, aggressive and living in smaller groups than before at the sea. This would go probably hand in hand with a lowered IQ. Brains had to make way for big jaws, muscles, bones and fangs. We would therefore be less cooperative and living, as I mentioned, in smaller bands. A second option would be to go back to eating plants and fruits, back to a life as a herbivore, a tree-climbing fruit eater. A bit like a panda bear, meat eater gone back to eating plants, bamboo shoot in this case, without losing very much of the properties of his meat-eating cousins. But none of this happened. We more or less stayed the same. Why? A very exciting idea is that the dog came in and saved our lives. He compensated our weaknesses on smell, sound and speed. Wolves are cooperative and social by nature. It is known they follow humans and live off their remains, what's left over from the hunt. For a long time it was thought that this would take too long. Before the wolf had become a dog, man would have died out in the circumstances it was not adapted to. But recent experiments changed this idea completely. By the way, the guy on the picture is me, with my old dog Taff during a sheepdog trial. Domestication is proven to go much faster than previously thought. Experiments in the Russian fur industry to breed an easily to handle fox showed it is possible to create a docile fox in less than 20 generations, about 20 years or so. Maybe wolves didn't domesticate this fast, but it surely wouldn't take that long. Domestication became a feasible project. So, together with his most loyal companion, man survived. As a team, they were able to track and kill big prey. Man had invented fire to overcome the limits of his small and weak mouth and jaws. Man survived a very tricky period in his evolution, thanks to the dog. Think about that when you cuddle your loyal friend next time. In our next video, we will cover a completely different topic. We are going to talk about innovation. Technological innovation, social innovation, new philosophies, new ways people feel, dress, eat and enjoy. So, innovation in its broadest sense. You will learn how Darwin thinking can help us understand the development of our society and technology. Some very surprising lines of thought will be presented. If you like this video, please share it. And don't forget to like and subscribe.